HarperCollins presents Beak, Tooth and Claw by Mary Colwell. Read by Mary Colwell. Introduction. As ravenous wolves come swooping down on lambs or kids to snatch them away from right amidst their flock, so the Achaeans maul the Trojans. The term predator is usually ascribed to large meat-eaters, such as birds of prey, wolves and big cats, and is derived from praedator, the Latin for plunderer. Predation, a verb to describe hunting and killing for food, comes from predare, to rob. The word predator, therefore, means a thief that steals life, and predation is the act of plundering and pillaging. These harsh definitions evoke immorality and ruthlessness, and appear in ancient literature to portray violent human behaviour, a dominant force attacking and consuming the weak and vulnerable. The Roman poet Ovid describes the rape of the mythical goddess Philomela by her brother-in-law Tereus as an act of predation. The captive has no chance to escape, and the raptor sits eyeing his prey. She, Philomela, trembled like a quivering lamb, who, after it has been wounded and then spat out by a grey wolf, cannot yet believe it is safe. Or like a dove whose feathers are smeared with its own blood, and who still shudders with fear of those greedy talons that pierced her skin. Writing in the pre-modern era, James Tyrrell, in his 1697 History of England, uses a word which has predation at its root, depredations, to describe an English army setting out to repel a violent Scottish invasion. The Yorkshiremen, being resolved to put a stop to these depredations, raised an army of about 10,000 men. In modern vernacular, the term predator has been appropriated to describe someone who hunts down a victim for sex or even murder. Throughout time, we have used the natural behaviour of wild creatures by analogy to impose moral judgment. And although we think of our 21st century selves as enlightened, rational and scientific, the ancient idea that ruthless predators attack innocent victims still has a hold on the popular imagination. Contradictions swirl around predators. We may fear and often revile them, but we also admire their beauty and strength. Beguiled by their fur or their plumage, we have stripped these from their bodies and fashioned them into coverings for our own skins, often to convey status, wealth, and sex appeal. For thousands of years, we have folded our dreams and our flaws into predator pelts, playing with the image of ourselves. If we don't literally inhabit their skins, we take on their image. Big cats, eagles, and bears, creatures we associate with dominance and courage, commonly adorn heraldic shields and advertising billboards. Predators the world over hold our stories. Even the way we speak and convey ideas is bound to our concept of predators. They weave through our speech as metaphor and simile, casting light onto human nature. Sly as a fox, eagle-eyed, a wolf in sheep's clothing, political hawks and doves, brave as a lion. And yet our primal fear of predators and the damage they can cause to both our bodies and our livelihoods can provoke such intense emotions that we drive them to extinction. They are too in-your-face, too disruptive, too damaging, simply too much like us to be tolerated. Predators, large and small, are the most persecuted creatures on earth. They always have been, and still are, gods or vermin, heroes or villains. There is nothing straightforward about how we use the terms predator and predation. They are redolent with meaning beyond the necessity of killing to eat. The pure biological definition is much broader and simpler. Predators kill other living creatures for all or part of their diet. This applies to vast swathes of life on Earth, including some plants. Sharks, peregrines and wolves are predators, but so too are minnows, blue tits and dormice. But as the complex emotional and cultural beings that we are, we have discarded the biological definition and formed our own human-centred categorisation, which holds on to vestiges of the past associations. In the modern mind's eye, it is still a laden term for animals with an array of sharp beaks, claws, talons and teeth, weaponry that can damage us physically and metaphorically. Predators are, therefore, what we want them to be, and that is very often far beyond reality. This book focuses on British meat-eaters, the ones living alongside us now, the long-gone extinct creatures, and the predators that may reappear in the future. It is about our relationship with them, but because of our complex perceptions, it is as much about people as it is about the animals themselves. It may feel as though the realm of predators and predation is remote from our modern urban lives, that these bloody activities belong out there in the wilderness and shown in wildlife documentaries. But in reality, we are all surrounded by predators every day. As I sit and write on a bright spring day in Bristol, a blue tit picks aphids off roses to feed its chicks. And overhead, swifts swoop and swerve, snapping insects from the air, not unlike sharks feasting on shoals in the ocean. Over Somerset's fields and copses, mewing buzzards soar on thermals to hunt rabbits, small birds and insects, while crows scan the landscape from their perches, searching for a nest of chicks. Along the Bristol Channel, seals pursue fish, a bounty they share not only with us, but with the myriad screeching seabirds that plunge into the tidal race. As evening falls, the languid song of a blackbird is a wildwood lament for a long-gone landscape of open forest. This black-coated chorister is also a prolific killer. On one birding forum, an astonished gardener writes, "Whilst digging up my very neglected garden to grow veggies, I am enjoying the company of a male blackbird. He appears within minutes of me starting to dig and approaches to within a metre or so. In one 10-minute session, he consumed 3 medium-sized worms, 2 big ones, 5 centipedes, 1 leather jacket, 1 grub species unknown, and 1 spider. He also appeared to consume 6 insects that were too small for me to see. In 2 more visits this afternoon, he seemed to eat similar amounts. He is not taking food away, and I have not seen any sign of a female, so I'm assuming he's not paired up yet. I am amazed at the quantity he can put away." When night falls, moonlit woodlands will see tawny owls land on branches, as silent as ghosts, listening, waiting for the small and scuttling creatures to feed their owlets. Tiny bones and teeth will appear in pellets, scattered among the leaves. This witching hour also sees bats replace the swifts as aerial hunters, and in the milky shadows, hedgehogs devour worms and foxes feast on rabbits and voles. All over the country, day and night, in the city, out in the fields, under the water and in the air, there is an orgy of predation, an odious scene of violence and tyranny, in the words of philosopher John Stuart Mill. Yet despite the plethora of killing, blackbirds and blue tits are considered garden delights, and we assign them a different category to sparrowhawks, which hunt and kill these small birds. Perhaps it is because common garden birds eat worms and insects, creatures we don't relate to, and their act of predation doesn't involve spilling blood, that we downgrade them to something much softer and less menacing than a full-blown, meat-eating predator. They are, though, officially in that category. So too are great tits, only slightly larger than their blue cousins. These tick-tocking, busybody birds are opportunists. They are as happy feeding off a bird table as on a carcass left by a large predator. They have even been recorded eating the flesh of hanged people. Ornithologist John Barnes wrote of their murderous tendency and described a group of pied flycatchers found dead with smashed skulls in nest boxes taken over by great tits. Their powerful bills can crack acorns and hazelnuts, as well as the skulls of hibernating bats, where they splinter the bone and then eat the brains. Author Becky Crew dubbed them zombie tits. Even so, they are still one of the nation's favourite birds. It is part of the predator paradox that we consider some creatures as predators but exclude others. And even this restricted category is filled with subtle subdivisions. There are courageous predators, such as lions and bears, on whose muscular shoulders we project our ideal of strength and dignity in battle. Aerial predators like eagles and hawks speak to our yearning for mastery of the skies and freedom from the shackles that bind us to the earth. We admire the endurance and teamwork of pack hunters like wild dogs, wolves and hyenas. Most fearsome of all are the alien, cold-blooded killers in the form of sharks and crocodiles, chilling in their seeming lack of emotion. These are apex predators at the top of the food chain. They eat large prey and have big territories. They are the red in tooth and claw creatures, the ones most likely to spring to mind when the word predator is mentioned. Beneath them are the smaller and more numerous meso, middle-sized predators, which usually have a wider diet and are often regarded as a nuisance rather than with fear. The cunning fox and the fast and furious weasel, for example, are exasperating in their ability to evade our control. There are also those predators that occupy a shifting hinterland, a permeable place, where creatures come and go depending on who is looking at them. Badgers are lovable bumblers when they eat grubs, but we are thrown into cognitive dissonance when they overturn a hedgehog and devour the soft underbelly. Hedgehogs themselves are cute when curled in a ball, but they also devour the helpless nestlings of ground-nesting birds. These are the confusing creatures, the ones that challenge our concept of adorable and sit uneasily alongside wolves and eagles. The hunters we place on the outside of the blooded predator box are creatures such as songbirds, waders and small mammals, because they target prey that we dislike or have no relationship with. We cannot understand our reaction to hunters without acknowledging our attitude to the hunted. We know this scenario. A wildlife documentary shows a lioness crouched in long grass. She is hungry and locked on to a young antelope that has strayed from its mother. It walks with delicate poise through shimmering heat. The lioness inches forwards. Time slows down and the moments stretch. The calf is naive and unaware of its imminent, violent death, and we will it to flee. Then, without warning, a burst of energy, confusion, and the sound of fear sees the calf die with its throat in the grip of canines that are 10 times longer than our own. It is helpless in the face of such overpowering aggression. As life ebbs from its body, we are flooded with complex emotions. Most of us will never have direct contact with antelope in the wild, yet there is an understanding of the terror and pain that is woven through this narrative. We have entered the drama. The word empathy combines the Greek word for feeling, pathia, with the prefix en, giving a sense of within. Empathia, literally to be in feeling with something or someone, to be inside what they are experiencing. The word empathy only appeared in common usage in the early 20th century, but it gives additional depth to the term sympathy, which is a more surface recognition of suffering. Sympathy acknowledges distress, empathy shares it. Empathy is not abstract or conceptual, it is focused on an individual. We place ourselves in the position of the one who is suffering and imagine their pain. Empathy for prey is the other side of the fear of predation, and it is deeply human. As humanity evolved as hunter-gatherers, first in Africa and then across the world, it was safer to live in small groups with strong social bonds. The ever-present threat of attack from other tribes or dangerous wildlife required social cohesion, cemented by caring and sharing. Empathy emerged out of this sociability, the ability to connect deeply with another's feelings. It is highly developed in human beings, but it is also found in varying degrees in primates, elephants, cetaceans, and rodents. Without empathy, we too easily disregard suffering, causing relationships and communities to fall apart. The Dutch primatologist Frans de Waal believes empathy is so important, he places it at the heart.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.